take the first point first. We all know this, right? There's nothing new that I'm telling you here. Let me tell you a little bit of history, and this anecdote comes from a book that I'm going to, the title of which I'm going to share in the next slide. It talks about an olden era. It talks about, meaning many hundreds of years back. None of us were alive at that point in time. It talks about an era where gold was aluminium was more valuable than gold. Sounds crazy, right? There was actually such a time where aluminium was a very, very expensive metal, almost a precious metal, actually a precious metal. Why would that be the case? All of us know that gold is scarce or platinum is scarce, whereas aluminium is relatively easily available. But the technology prevalent at that time was such that aluminium was not easy to extract. And that's why aluminium was more expensive than gold. And obviously, once the technology came by, then the prices of aluminium crashed, and we know what the situation is today. The same book, I think, talks about a period when pearls were very valuable, moti, as we call it in Hindi. So pearls were things which occurred naturally, and you had to find them, and they were very, very difficult to come by. And that's why the pearl necklaces or the special type of pearls were very, very expensive. However, later on, people figured out how to create the same pearl in an artificial environment. And then pearls lost their value as very, very expensive things. Today, to some extent, the same thing is happening with diamonds. So diamonds, originally people thought that naturally if carbon is subject to many, many years of heat and pressure and all that, then it crystallizes and you have these naturally occurring diamonds. And those are very, very valuable. But now we have figured out how to create those diamonds, not the cubic zirconia or the American diamonds as they are called, but diamonds which are chemically indistinguishable from naturally occurring diamonds. And if there was no marking, then even jewelers would find it tough or may not be able to distinguish the lab created diamonds versus naturally occurring diamonds. So what happens is, as technological improvement comes by, there is a tendency in society, in the human affairs, that things which were very, very expensive or difficult to come by in the past become very, very easily available to the general population. So Warren Buffett likes to say this, and he says that the lifestyle of a middle-class American today, or even in some cases of a poor American today, would be far, far better than the lifestyle of kings and emperors maybe 200, 300 years back. Because think about it, at that time they did not have access to the medical services that commoners have today, or to air travel, or to mobile telephony and internet and things like that. Further, there is globalization. So earlier, again, I am old enough to remember a time when one had to wait 5 years for a landline telephone connection.
Never miss an update.
And today you can just walk into any store with your Aadhaar number and you can get a SIM card in 5 minutes and have a phone activated, or you have a choice of various bikes in the news, you can use, there was reference to the Ola electric scooters and things like that. So today we live in a competitive era. There's global competition. So despite whatever happens to monetary policy and despite whatever happens to the inflation expectations and things like that, that people worry about, I would argue that the technological trends that are there are very, very compelling over the long run and which tamp down the inflation. And today, we don't live in an era where one could be opaque in terms of pricing and things like that, because as the earlier idea television advertisement goes, we live in an era of no ullu banaving. So today people go to a showroom and look at the display prices, and immediately on the mobile phone, they check competing prices with, on Amazon or Flipkart or with other stores and all of that. So we don't live in an era where you can fool the customer or you can overcharge the customer. So this part is arguing for a low inflation world, not just in the present, but also in the future. And this is the book that I was referring to. It's called Abundance, and the future is better than you think. The author is Peter Diamandis. The name is not very clear at the bottom, but so this is one part of the equation. So when your clients are investing or afraid of inflation, this is one point of view that you can bring to the client, saying don't worry too much about inflation. The second side of the argument, where I'm arguing that inflation rates are actually very, very high, and the savings of clients and the investments of clients will not be sufficient for them to meet their actual goals, is this. When so much money gets printed by central banks the world over, when governments give so much of fiscal incentives and run some very high deficits, what happens is a small segment of the population, relatively, is able to corner a lot of the purchasing power. This is happening in developed countries as well as in countries like India. So when some people have a lot of purchasing power, then whatever good or whatever service does not have infinite supply, or wherever the technological innovations have not come by as yet, or wherever there's no global competition, in such goods and services, the inflation rate can be very, very high. So think about it. If all the industrialists, if all the film actors, film stars, if all the top lawyers, surgeons in the city of Mumbai got a lot of money, what do you think will happen to the luxury real estate market in the city of Mumbai? The answer is clearly prices will go crazy, right? People will outbid each other to buy that one bungalow or plot of land or one sea-facing luxury apartment. So, or if, let's say, if there is one school where all the elite people send their kids, and that school wants to reduce the student intake, what do you think will happen to the fees? They'll keep on hiking fees, which are going up far in, which are going up at a very rapid pace, which has nothing to do with the inflation rate in the overall economy. Or let's say if there's a surgeon who has a reputation of being the best at conducting a life-saving surgery, maybe let's say a liver transplant or something. Now, if every wealthy person wants to avail of the services of this particular individual, that person will go on jacking up the cost of surgery and the cost of the medical procedure. And further, there will always be newer and newer things. So while the inflation rate of a cell phone may not be very high, so a Nokia 5110, which came out maybe 20 years back, today will be available virtually for free, and it may even not even work because unless it's a 2G network or something. But the latest iPhone is far more expensive than the first iPhone that came out. Or completely new categories are being created. Let's say a Apple Watch, which people never knew that they needed. People would buy one HMT or a one Titan watch or a one Rolex watch and keep it for generations. Today, you need to change your watch every year or every 2 years because newer and newer features get added and the old one is not good enough. So depending on what is your product basket and depending on what are your actual needs, inflation rate for you can be very, very different from the published inflation rates that the government gives by or the central banks give. So what is the solution? I don't have a clear answer in terms of the solution for coming out with the inflation rate, but it helps in terms of thinking in terms of goals, or rather than assuming a omnibus inflation for the client, it may help to break up the client's expenditure into various buckets. So let's say if the client's expenditure on grocery is 10%, then assume a particular rate of inflation for the grocery expenditure. If the client's goal is to buy premium residential real estate, let's say in Pedder Road or in Worli Seaface or Bandra, then the real estate inflation rate that you assume will be much higher than the consumer price index inflation rate that you would see. So it may make sense to break down the client expenditure and the client goals and assume a different inflation rate for each aspect separately. Broadband prices, I don't think will go up in line with the medical expense prices or with real estate prices. The electricity expenditure actually may come down in the future years because the way the developments are happening in the renewable energy space, energy will be plentiful and energy will be cheaper in the future as compared to what we have right now, at least 10 years from now or 15 years from now. That's the way I see it. So it may make sense to break up the client goals and expenditures to arrive at a blended inflation.